A defiant demand to restore democracy in Myanmar has been met with a dramatic escalation in violence by security forces. The UN says nearly 40 people were killed on Wednesday, including four children, according to one aid agency. Witnesses say police and soldiers opened fire with live rounds and with little warning. One activist called it a massacre. And a warning now, these next images are difficult to watch. Security forces were caught on video ordering three charity workers out of an ambulance and then beating them with their guns and batons.
Today, it was the bloodiest day since the coup happened on the 1st of February. We had today, only today, 38 people died. We have now more than over 50 people died since the coup started, and many are wounded.
For the very latest now, live to Seoul, CNN's Paula Hancock's following developments for us in Myanmar. So what do we know about the situation right now and the ongoing violence there? And where is it being contained to certain cities, or is it just now spreading across the country?
Well, John, effectively, it is across the country. We're not seeing these protests and then the clashes or the violence used by the military and police in just the rural areas or just the cities. It is definitely across the whole country. And we are seeing, there's no doubt, an increase in the level of force that is being used by security forces. There are a number of live streams throughout the day, a number of videos being posted on social media showing those who have been injured or who have been killed, many of them far too graphic to be able to be shown on air. But it does show that the level of violence that we are seeing on the streets of Myanmar is unfortunately increasing. Now, the United Nations say that they believe 38 were killed on Wednesday, which is the deadliest day so far since the coup took place on February 1st. And they have a total of 50, they believe, have been killed. But when you speak to activists on the ground, they fear that the number is far higher than that. That is just the number that the UN has been able to confirm. And despite this level of force being used increasing, we are still seeing thousands of protesters coming out onto the streets and insisting they want to continue to protest. Many of those that I've spoken to say that they see this as the final battle. They feel that if they lose this particular battle against what they call the military dictatorship, then that would be worse than being injured or worse in a protest, but having to live through another military dictatorship. John?
And what about the party of Aung San Suu Kyi, and in fact Aung San Suu Kyi herself, are they playing any role in this? Do we know where they are? Do we know if they can actually negotiate with the military leaders at this point? Is that even possible?
All we know of, for example, Aung San Suu Kyi, the ousted leader, is she has had two court appearances. They've both been by video conference. On both of the occasions, she had extra charges levelled against her. And a similar thing for the president, or the ousted president of the country as well. They're unable to get messages out to protesters at this point. But you would assume that they are talking to the military leadership. But of course, it is a legal process at this point. A legal process that the military leadership has changed the rules of on a number of occasions. But it certainly appears to be the case that we won't see much of Aung San Suu Kyi or many of the NLD, the National League for Democracy members that were rounded up on February 1st, right at the beginning of this coup. And clearly there is a reason for that. The military says they believe there was voter fraud at the end of last year, which the Election Commission says did not happen. But they want to make sure that if there is another election, then they are not having to go up against Aung San Suu Kyi again, who will likely win another landslide. John?
Paula, thank you. Paula Hancock for the very latest there on the situation in Myanmar, live from Seoul. Thank you, Paula. To Washington now, and joining us this hour is the United Nations Special Rapporteur for Myanmar, Tom Andrews. Mr. Andrews, thank you for being with us.
John, thank you.
The coup leaders were reportedly surprised when these protests first began a few weeks ago. Initially, the military seemed to take a much softer approach. Now, as the demonstrations have continued and grown in size, soldiers are firing live rounds of ammunition. People are dying. The Archbishop of Yangon tweeted, "Today, the country is like the Tiananmen Square in most of its major cities." How much further will this escalate? And do you suspect the violence and the crackdown is a lot worse than what we're seeing?
Well, I'm afraid, John, it could very well. We're talking about a a regime here and a military that is infamous for its brutality. We've seen what they're capable of doing, certainly in protests in the past. And of course, we're now seeing that brutality play out on the streets of not just the major cities, but in smaller communities and townships. This is going on all over the country. It is escalating. And the regime is demonstrating to the world just how brutal it's capable of being.
Has this gone beyond the point of no return and some kind of negotiated settlement here?
You know, it has to stop, John. It just has to stop. Because this the gruesome reality that we're seeing unfolding every single day just can't continue. Now, we've seen police officers crossing lines. We've seen some evidence of some soldiers unable to continue with the brutality. We're hoping that trend will take hold and continue. But this is a protest movement that is very broad, very deep. There's just incredible opposition throughout the country to this coup and its aftermath. So the generals have very, very little support except for their weapons.
Well, the coup leaders have said that elections will be held in a year from now. There's no sort of details on the timetable. But what we're seeing playing out here is this roundup of all the prominent members of the democratically elected NDL party. That's the party of Aung San Suu Kyi. They're being convicted or charged on these trumped up charges. And then ultimately, it seems like it will lead to some kind of ban on the party. And is this the strategy? Leave the way open for these coup leaders to win a rigged election in 12 months?
Well, I mean, no one believes, and I don't, it's just incredible to me that they continue to make these statements. Of course, Aung San Suu Kyi, the charges change, it seems, every other day. She's not allowed to see her attorney. It's the same with the president, and same with people all over the country that are being literally taken from their homes, the wee hours of the morning, taken away. Their families still don't know where they are, how they are, what they're charged with. So this is an incredible scene that's going on all over the country. So when the generals say, oh, don't worry, we'll have elections in a year's time, and oh, don't worry, we'll make sure that they're fair. No one believes that, and it wouldn't surprise me if very few people within the military believe that. They have zero credibility whatsoever.
There's now this agreement for most countries that something needs to be done, and something needs to be done quickly to force the military to give power back to the civilian government. The question is what? Singapore's Prime Minister raised this concern. Here he is.
Outsiders have very little influence on this. You can ostracize them, you can condemn them, you can pass resolutions or not. But it really has very little influence on what the Myanmars will do. It had zero influence the last time round, and the only impact was, for lack of anybody willing to talk to them, they fell back on those people who were willing to talk to them, which was China.
You know, one of the messages from both the US State Department and the UN has been for a global unified response. That response has to be unified, but while you have Beijing, especially, as well as Moscow, giving the generals a get-out-of-jail-free card, this response will be ineffective, won't it?
Yeah, you know, I think that's it's simply not true that they are not going to listen to the world. I mean, we know that they did before, and of course, for the generals, money talks the loudest, and when there was coordinated sanctions back 10 years ago, they responded. In fact, the developing democracy that was overthrown by these generals actually occurred precisely because of the generals succumbing to the pressure of sanctions. So what I think is really important, obviously it would be great if China could extend its influence. They have a self-interest here. They don't want to see a conflagration right on over their border, right there, a neighboring country. So they have a lot at stake. But whether they do or not, if the world could unite together and have coordinated, focused sanctions, we have right now a hodgepodge of sanctions regimes, coordinate them, make them work together, toughen them, not just on individuals, but businesses and business interests. And then if the Security Council could be so moved as to, in their meeting this Friday, consider a reference to the International Criminal Court or signal that that's coming. And if the generals understood that they were going to be held accountable for these atrocities, that might make a difference as well.